Okay, ready to go. I am Peter Drucker, and I'm speaking from Claremont, California. All the management books and management magazines are full of advice how to manage other people. And yet you cannot hope to get performance out of other people unless you make yourself fully effective. The emphasis on your effectiveness, and I will talk about the things we know that make an executive effective in whatever kind of organization. So I start out with looking at the enterprise of which they are the executives and see what needs to be done. Let me say the most common cause why chief executives, whether in the presidency of a country or in an archdiocese or in a business or in a hospital, the first reason why they are not effective is that they do not ask that question and do not take it seriously. They know what they want to do, and so they start doing it. And if history is any guide, about 9 out of 10 effective rulers in history, kings, emperors, presidents, changed what they were trying to do because they asked the question, what needs to be done? And it always, or almost always, turns out it is not what I want to do. It's what the enterprise needs. And what would make a very real difference. And then they ask, what are the things in that list of key results, key performance, where I can make the greatest contribution myself? And they concentrate on them. Executives in any organization, large or small, governmental, business, non-profit, all of them, need to be seen as addressing themselves and working themselves on the key challenges. And so the next step in being an effective executive is to think through. So with an enormous list of 40 people, 40 things. And nobody can do more than one or two at a time. And so an effective executive sets priorities and sticks to them. And so we can accomplish something. The ones who are often very popular but leave nothing behind but shambles are the ones who run off in all directions. And then effective people, and not just effective executives, know their strengths. You take that for granted with artists, but it is just as true with a business executive.
Mozart era uma pessoa impossível de ser empregada. A única coisa que ele sabia fazer era compor músicas divinas, e foi isso que fez sempre. Mas era incapaz de administrar suas próprias finanças sem nem pensar em finanças alheias.
So, what are your strengths? And I'm almost appalled at how few people know that. In part because the schools are all remedial. There you are 8 years old and supposed to learn the multiplication table, and you're not very good at it. And your teacher will never mention to your parents that you're excellent at writing, excellent at analysis. All that third grade teacher will say is your child needs more work in arithmetic. There's a very easy way to find out, which is that every time you make a key decision, such as putting a person into an important job, or going into a new market, or spending money on research on the edges of knowledge, you write down what you expect the results will be. And then 9 months to a year later, your feedback from your expectations to your results. A very sobering exercise, by the way. I do it every summer now. I've done it for 30 years, and every summer I'm amazed, not at the things I do well, not at the things I do badly, but how little I really know about what I'm good at. And that's been true of all people who follow that method. It's a very old one. We want to know Spanish 13th century. And within no time at all, you'll know what you're good at. And you know what additional skills and knowledge you need to acquire to get the full benefit from your strengths. And you know what to stop doing because it impairs your strengths. And you also know what you are not good at. And most of us, if you are any good, are good at one thing, competent on two others, and no downward on the rest of everything. And effective executives place themselves where what they're good at really makes a difference and work at it. You know, all of you people by now know whether you're right-handed and left-handed. 100 years ago,
há 100 anos, ninguém sabia porque os canhotos eram corrigidos. Hoje, quando uma criança de 2 anos usa a mão esquerda para colocar comida na boca, a avó não faz mais o que minha avó fazia comigo. Dava-me um tapa na mão e dizia, coma com a mão direita.
As a result, I've never really gotten a strong right hand, but I don't have a developed left hand. And now we let lefties develop their strengths. But that isn't just true of bi-handedness. Most of us are either readers or listeners. Very few do both equally well. And if you're a reader, you owe it to the people who work with you to tell them. Don't come in talking to me. Write out that 1 or 2 page memo. Give me a chance to read it, and then I'm ready to talk. So find out whether you're a reader or a listener. Very few people are both. And if you're a listener, say to your associates, I am a listener. Present it to me first, then leave the memo. And if you're a reader, say, leave the memo here, come back tomorrow. And it will triple your effectiveness, guaranteed, because I've seen it too often. But also, some of us do the best work in the morning, and we need to be undisturbed. And your predecessor was an evening person, the way I am. I
Sempre trabalhei melhor depois do jantar, entre o jantar e meia-noite. Na parte da manhã, falo ao telefone, converso com as pessoas. Mas quando procuro escrever alguma coisa na parte da manhã, geralmente acabo jogando tudo fora e fazendo outra vez.
And I have learned to say that to the people who work with me, including my clients. And it perhaps accounts for the fact that at my age, I'm still the most popular management consultant in the USA. And there are a great many people, I'm not one of them, a great many people who, well, in order to get the most of a conversation, a discussion, take copious notes. I don't write a word in a meeting. Afterwards, I sit down and write it down. In a meeting, I've learned the way I work is I listen carefully. But I don't interrupt with note-taking. And I have a very competent friend who's the exact opposite. Know how you get results, how you work, and make sure the people with whom you work know that. And when you say to that associate of yours who was trained by your predecessor to write memoranda, say, Joe, I want you to come in and speak first. And you may have to say it a few times. And Joe will thank you for it. So don't hesitate to tell people this is how I work. And it's very easy to adapt oneself to somebody else's working methods. It is almost impossible to change one's working methods. As you grow older, they change. But not deliberately change them. Yes, one can learn to be punctual, even in Brazil. But beyond that, don't change your habits. Not that easy. And perhaps the final thing to say about your personal effectiveness is organize your self-development. I learned this many years ago from some of the most effective executives I worked with. And again, this is pretty old. Once a year, I sit down, push everything else aside for 2 weeks. I'll do it again this coming August. And I sit down and look at the last year. What did I really do well? Very often I call up and ask a client. In fact, this morning before I came sit for the camera, I called up an archbishop who is a client who inherited an American archdiocese that's in a terrible mess.
Seu antecessor era um santo. As pessoas gostavam muito dele. Mas todos os telhados da arquidiocese estão com goteiras e ninguém escapa da chuva.
Here's a new man, very able, and we have been now working for a year together to turn it around. And I called him up and said, what did I do while working with you? And he said, you focused me on the development of my clergy, which I had completely neglected. And you did that very well, by being very unpleasant about it, by the way, and so on. What did I do well? What did I waste my time on? Partly because I'm no good at it. Partly because it was not really important. It was just attractive. And very often because I did not follow through. Business clients have concentrated on the outside, the market, the customer, the non-customer. And I am going now, the next year, to concentrate very heavily on the inside. The new labor force is emerging. We have to learn a lot. And this is what my clients need the most. I also need it. And so I'll change the assignments I take. And a year from now, I'll sit down and look at it again. And anybody who has ever done that, and I told you this goes back hundreds of years, has developed himself or herself. Yes, maybe I've come to the conclusion, I once taught statistics almost 60 years ago, and I'm totally obsolete in statistics. They've changed so much. I am going for a 3-month reading course in modern statistics. I need it. Not because I am going to do statistical work, but because I have to understand statistics, and I no longer do, really. And this is self-development. And so let me say, in conclusion, the first person an effective or an executive who wants to be effective has to make effective is the executive himself or herself. Many years ago, the one major European diplomatist who foresaw World War I and was afraid of it was the German ambassador to London. And when he became dean of the diplomatic corps, the dean of the diplomatic corps gives an annual dinner to the king.
O rei Eduardo VII, como você provavelmente sabe, era um grande conquistador. E como naqueles dias todos os diplomatas eram homens, o jantar era só para homens. E em certo momento as luzes eram apagadas, um grande bolo era trazido, e do meio dele saltava uma prostituta nua. O embaixador alemão disse, não farei isso. Não quero olhar para meu espelho e ver um cafetão. Ele demitiu-se.
Now that's an extreme story, but a useful one. Look in the mirror and ask, do I want to be the person I see? Do I, because that's what everybody else sees. Do I want to be seen as very clever but not very scrupulous? Do I want to be seen as a technician? Or do I want to be seen as a businessman? A very important question. With technology changing so fast, and far too many of my friends, chief executive officers, want to be seen as a technician, where they should be running a business. Do I want to be the person I see? If not, what do I have to change? And those are the keys to making yourself an effective executive. They all sound very simple, but they are not easy. And yet every single effective executive I worked with, and I've now worked with executives for at least 60 years, beginning with very weak businesses, and only in the last 30 years have I taken on small businesses and non-for-profit organizations. So I've seen a lot of executives. Not very many, bluntly, were effective. They were all bright people, hard-working people, very hard-working. Lazy executives don't last long in a competitive economy. And not very many got the right things done. And the reason was always the same. They ask, what do I want to do and not what needs to be done. They didn't set priorities and stuck to them. They didn't check back on their results. By definition, executives work in an organization. And we really have barely learned to walk. We are still toddlers in organizations. Large organizations are not much more than 100 years old. And we are slow learners. But we know enough to see what an executive has to do and has to stop doing if he or she wants to be effective executives in an organization. And perhaps the first thing to say is that they have to make themselves understood.
Todos nós ainda acreditamos estar vivendo num mundo parecido com os exércitos de ontem. Todos são treinados para fazer exatamente a mesma coisa e apenas os números ficam maiores. E, portanto, podemos supor que os mais graduados sabem o que os menos graduados estão fazendo porque já passaram por isso.
If you look at today's organization, business, hospital, university, government, no two people have the same background, basically. And we can no longer take for granted that they understand what their neighbor is doing or that they have been on that job. Here is the head of market research, and he may have come out of the advertising agency, and he has never done any selling or any pricing or any customer service, and yet he is now accountable for. And so in an organization, executives have to take responsibility that they are being understood. Information are data that have been converted, that have relevance, that are, that cause us to act. What do I need? The management informations person cannot tell you, just as the telephone operator cannot tell you whom to call. And then one asks, what information do I owe to whom? And incidentally, it's a good idea when you have thought this through to go to that person and say, Jorge or Maria, am I right? This is the information you need to get from me. And you'll be surprised how often the answer is, well, not really quite, almost, because we no longer have to have been on the jobs these people are doing. We mean, they haven't done them. We may have read a book or two or taken a course or two. That's not quite the same thing as doing them. And so the first key to effectiveness is that your associates understand you and you understand them. That's also the secret of team building, by the way, of which you hear a great deal today. And I've been preaching teams for 40 years, and very few teams.
Muito poucas equipes funcionam, porque as pessoas partem do princípio de que o homem de marketing, chefe da equipe, entende tudo que o engenheiro está tentando fazer. Só que isso não é verdade. Agora, se o engenheiro pensar nos detalhes e contar para o chefe, e se todas as outras pessoas da equipe fizerem o mesmo, existirá a possibilidade de trabalharem em equipe.
What are we trying to accomplish? And to make sure that the whole organization understands it. That's one of the key jobs of the CEO. And in successful organization, they never stop. Because basically, you can't supervise people all the time. Most of the time, they have to do their own work themselves. And if they do not know how to fit it towards the goals of the organization, it won't fit. But that's for the top people in the organization, or but for everybody who runs the department. When I first sit down with such people, I said, try to explain to me what you in customer service are trying to do. And most of the time, they haven't thought it through. And then they complain that their associates in the field do a poor job. No, they have only themselves to blame. If the person at the top hasn't thought it through, nobody in the group will understand it and do it. So this may be the first thing to say. We haven't had organizations. Traditionally, people...
Historicamente, as pessoas viviam numa comunidade tradicional, na qual os relacionamentos eram claramente definidos. Esta senhora é minha tia, este outro é meu primo, esse é o pároco da igreja. As pessoas não precisavam se explicar.
And in modern organization, now things aren't that clear. Also, they change. And if the parish priest in the traditional church, yes, a new one came in every 25 years, but he did exactly what the old one had done. It had exactly the same role. He may have done it better or worse, but he did the same things. And today you are in that bank, and you start managing foreign exchange for your customers, and your people haven't done it before. Your clients don't understand it. You have to be clear about the mission and what the results. And that's the first key. An organization is only as strong as its people. And no organization, except very small ones, can really hope to have a large number of exceptional people. Once you are above, I would say, 100 and 150 employees, the law of statistics more or less commands that you have the normal mixture of the human race. Maybe you can eliminate the worst misfits. But that's about it.
As pessoas não são como ervilhas numa vagem. Elas são pessoas. Todas têm pontos fortes e fracos. Os gênios universais, se é que existem, são muito raros. Só Mozart sabia apenas compor música. Era a única coisa que sabia fazer. E, no entanto, em toda a história da música, não há ninguém que se compare a ele. Todos temos nossas fraquezas. Nem todos temos pontos fortes, mas todos temos fraquezas.
Place people where their strengths can produce. Look at people and their performance, what have they done well, and try to get them into a position where what they can do has results. Very few executives, even in large organizations, realize that they control the organization through people decisions. So spend time on people decisions. We know how to make them. One looks at the assignment before one looks at people, and one looks at the performance of a number of people. And this is particularly important in the family company. And in every country, there are 20 family companies for one that is publicly owned. only they don't make the headlines, so the outsider always knows the big companies in Brazil or in the US or in Argentina. And it doesn't know the smaller and still mostly family-run companies. And family companies come to grief because they run the business for the family, and the family company, the family has to be run for the business. And so it is cheaper to pay that incompetent nephew of your wife not to come to work than to give him a job. And that's a very important thing to know for the executive in family companies. He has to forget that this person is family. He has to look at the assignment and at the strengths of people and match the two. And then it becomes not necessarily irrelevant, but of secondary importance that this person is family and this one is not. Their job comes first, or the family company won't survive. And to be an effective executive in an organization, you have to learn to be able to play two different roles. There's a great deal of talk today, maybe yesterday is already over the hump, about our moving out of the command and control organization. Yes and no. The more knowledge workers you have in your organization, the less you can command. When the ship goes
Quando o navio está afundando, não se convoca uma reunião do staff, dá-se uma ordem para que todos tenham possibilidade de sobreviver. Sendo assim, comando e autoridade ainda são necessários, e a organização precisa saber quem tem essa autoridade.
Or you have debated for a year and a half whether you go into a new product line, different technology, probably different markets. And on the other hand, your old business is clearly going down. You need to go into a new one. And for a year and a half, you have made studies and written papers and had staff conferences. And then comes the point where somebody makes a decision and says, this is it. I had to learn to be a partner. It came very hard to me. And I had to learn to be very decisive, and that came easy to me. I am not by nature permissive, but I had to learn to balance. And those are the things to see. There's a great deal of talk today about walking around. Yes, it helps to get out of your office and walk around. But more important is being outside, where the market is, the customers, the non-customers, where the changes are. And to be effective in an organization, you also have to beat sense organs. And that means you have to walk around inside and maybe sit down with the people in your lab. I think it's important to ask, what can an executive do today to prepare himself or herself to be effective tomorrow? One of the things we know is that the next, I don't know how many years, but long years, will be turbulent years, because the speed of change is so great. Whether you're talking...
Se conversarmos com especialistas em dados demográficos, ficaremos sabendo que no mundo industrializado há uma greve de bebês. pois na Espanha, Itália, Grécia, Portugal e sul da França, praticamente não nascem mais bebês. E a previsão é de que o Japão, dentro de 60 anos, terá aproximadamente metade da população atual, porque nascem muito poucas crianças. Por outro lado, o número de pessoas idosas está aumentando muito rapidamente nos países desenvolvidos.
So you can predict that in the developed countries, demographics will become a major issue. And yes, in developed countries, but perhaps not yet in emerging countries, we will have to learn to work with people very much older than we used to work with, because the idea, even in the U.S., that you can retire at 65 is no longer tenable. And that's a major change. But also, the business enterprise has come to play quite a new role. Economically, the world is becoming increasingly integrated. Politically, it's becoming increasingly splintered. And the business enterprise is very much in the middle. One of the major mistakes of my professional life is that I invented the term profit center. There is no such thing. Inside a business, there are only cost centers. The only profit center is the customer whose check hasn't bounced. And we know nothing about the outside. The retail people know more than anybody else, because when that housewife pays at the checkout counter, there's a record. I work a lot with hospitals. It is very hard to figure out the outside, let alone results. When you make a part to be assembled by one of your customers, you may know a lot about that customer, but you know almost nothing about his customers. And yet his customers are your ultimate customers. Because if that direct customer of yours can't sell his automobile he manufactures, you don't get an order either. And so one of the important tasks for the executive head is to try to obtain more knowledge about the outside, both geographically and topically. And I'm always being asked by clients, what do I do? And I learned that from an old client of mine who built a very successful company before he died, much too young, he was barely 60.
Ele criou uma lei na sua empresa que dizia que ele e todo o grupo de gerentes, incluindo supervisores na fábrica, precisavam tomar o lugar de um vendedor que estivesse de férias duas vezes por ano durante duas semanas. Portanto, durante quatro semanas, todos eles estavam no campo vendendo.
And that built his company. This was in the healthcare field, and 10 years before anybody else, he realized the changes in both American, Canadian, and Japanese healthcare, and directed his company, hospital supply business, towards their new customers. And he had a 10-year advantage. And so, obtaining knowledge about the outside, and that means not just your customers, but your non-customers. In every business except the government monopoly, there are more people who don't buy your product or your service than people who buy it. Nobody has more. 50% of the market is very rare. Leading companies typically have about 24% or thereabouts. So 75% of the people who could be your customers, who might be your customers, are not. Why not? And so the outside is something in which, not that anybody can tell you, executive, yet, how to acquire that. But that's why now when I sit down with the executives, I say, what magazines do you read? What books do you read? And see, you are learning more and more about less and less. And yet you are not in the electronics business. But the whole industry is going there. So you better start subscribing to good electronics magazines. You know nothing about, you're a technical person. You better read a good management magazine so that you get a glimpse of outside. And that is becoming more and more important. But also realize that we are building organizations around knowledge now. And knowledge is a very peculiar resource. All older resources changed very, very little. My name is a Dutch name. It means printer, and my ancestors were printers in Amsterdam for 250 years. They began shortly after printing was invented, 50 years later, lasted till the end of the 18th century, and during the entire almost three centuries, they did not have to learn anything new. That skill did not change.
Hoje, um engenheiro, um médico, um advogado, um contador, um gerente de serviços, que não procurar atualizar seus conhecimentos durante 3 ou 4 anos, tornar-se-á obsoleto muito, muito rapidamente, de forma incrivelmente rápida.
And so you, to prepare yourself for the future, better learn to build continuous learning into your own life. It may be going to a management meeting and listen to an expert. It may be reading this book, certainly magazines. It may be even going back to the university for an advanced management program. But build that stimulation that you realize how much is going on. A good deal of it will not affect you and your business, but quite a bit will, and if you then are overtaken by it. In the last 40 years, more old companies have been put out of business by rivals of whose very existence they didn't even know than at any time in history, because the competition now comes. You are in pharmaceutical, the competition comes from genetics and biomedicine, of which you know nothing. You are in the telephone business, and in this country, the internet is becoming a very serious competitor. The younger people don't use the telephone. And for the first time since the telephone was invented, telephone use and telephone subscription go down quite fast. And those people in the telephone companies had never heard of the internet. That was not our business. Our voice communications, either via cable or via satellite. And the younger people don't use the telephone. They use the internet, electronic mail. And so you better know what goes on. And perhaps one final important caveat, least important to you in Latin America, because you are old hands. You have learned the hard way to manage your currency exposure. In countries with built-in inflation, you learn that. Though, if you don't mind my saying that, you are not necessarily very good at it.
Você ficaria surpreso ao ver quantos homens de negócios nos países desenvolvidos ainda acreditam que a Bíblia começa com as palavras: no início Deus criou moedas estáveis. Na verdade, a Bíblia começa com as palavras: no início havia o caos.
And that is what currencies are. And accept the fact that this isn't going to change. As all of you know, the Europeans have not really been able to get one currency because no one country was willing to give up its fiscal independence, and that's not going to change for a long time. And yet, more and more businesses are exposed either as buyers or as sellers, or very often as debtors or creditors. And so, managing currencies is becoming an important task. It's got to be done for the entire enterprise in one place. Well, that's one reason where even the most decentralized multinational company is thoroughly centralized in currency management. And it's got to be taken seriously, because overnight a currency devalues and you lose more than you can possibly earn during a year's honest hard work making your product or delivering your service. And so currency management, where we know quite a bit, not nearly enough, but quite a bit, is one of the things an executive has to learn to be prepared for the future. But above all, he has to be prepared, or she, for change. And so you also have to learn how one introduces change. One doesn't do it the way most of us do it and most governments do it. A change for the whole country overnight never works. Think through the new policy, the new product, the new service. Find somebody in your company who really believes in it, who wants it, on one condition: that this person also enjoys the respect of your organization. And then let him or her pilot it. First, everything new has to be changed. Everything new gets into trouble. And then you need somebody who is the champion, who is committed to it. But you also need to do it where, if it goes wrong, it doesn't kill your company. And it better be somebody who is respected in the organization, so that people say, I still don't understand that, but it works for Jorge. And I've learned that Jorge has results. For 10 years, he has performed. I respect him. And if he says, try it, it works, I'll do it. So you will learn to build the management of change into your organization, but also into your life. Because one thing is predictable, that the period of turbulence and change is not over. Maybe 40 years ago, 30 years ago, the most intelligent man in management was a Japanese, Kenichi Omai. Predicted that only the developed countries matter. He calls them the triad. In the last 20 years, the developed countries have not done very well. U.S. best of all, then Japan, Europe has done very badly. And yet world production has grown faster than ever before, and world trade even faster, because the Pacific Rim countries and some countries in Latin America didn't even notice that Japan was in deep depression. Europe didn't move, and the U.S. was very uneven. There is no more key currency. There is no more key country. Development can happen any place, and that makes for a very turbulent time. And so one cannot predict the future, but one can prepare for it. And again, this is Peter Drucker speaking in Claremont, California.